This is the Bulla River, Kawatiri, inland from Westport on the South Island's west coast. This is the same stretch of road exactly in 2021. The bank is gone, the river having risen metres. This is from 1993. Nothing but river, and nowhere for the water to go but down to Westport.
Well, I got flooded, lost everything. I just hope there's no more floods.
Can you engineer your way out of climate change?
Look, no, not forever. And all the science and the expertise would tell us that.
That's Paul Zannon and I below. And this field, these fields, these paddocks, which look nondescript and ordinary, contain the seeds of an audacious possibility, a future beyond the floodplains.
So this is the future we're standing in front of here.
Well, it could be. It has to play a part.
That's footage from a documentary that is out now, came out yesterday. It's on TVNZ Plus, called John Campbell's Small Town Survival Guide. It's all about the massive decisions some towns have to make if they're going to have a future at all. Remember, many of them are in large areas with a tiny ratepayer base, not much money to work with. One of them is Westport, under severe flooding risk that will get worse. And considering a managed retreat to a new, more highly elevated site, they're just starting to discuss this. It's pretty audacious. So, what lessons can they learn from other New Zealand towns? Sorry. What lessons can New Zealand towns learn from overseas? Professor Nicholas Pinter is a geologist at the University of California. He's a world expert on managed retreat. I started by asking him, why make this subject your life's work?
Yeah, well, it's not so surprising, but maybe a slippery slope. So I'm a geomorphologist, a geologist of the Earth's surface, spend a lot of time studying rivers and flooding. And then you get into flood policy, and then you discover these strange cases of managed retreat and community relocation that are just super interesting histories.
Absolutely. I want to go back all the way back to 1881. You say it's super interesting. I'm fascinated by this town near Niobrara. Is that, am I saying I'm butchering it?
Niobrara, Nebraska.
So they're on the banks of the Missouri, and they just think to themselves, we're out of here. How the hell did they make that decision?
Well, it was a pretty bad flood. It's 2 meters of water in the center of town. Some of the men of the town actually rode it out on the second floor of the bank building, apparently drinking pretty heavily up there for several weeks till the water subsided. And then they gathered the community together and said, never again. This is just too much of a price to pay for being on the banks of the river. And they upped and moved themselves, literally dragging many of the structures up the hill.
And so the never again is informative, isn't it? And that's the conversation we need to have, because we are watching communities in New Zealand do again and again and again. And at what stage does the never enter the conversation?
Right. So it's rarely just one flood. Sometimes, but what we've seen is it often takes a 1-2 punch, too closely spaced disaster events that convince people this is more than just a one-off, an act of God. Sometimes more. So Pattonsburg, Missouri had been flooded 33 times when finally in 1993 they decided no 34th, that they were going to, that was enough to get them to do the relocation.
This is a fascinating paper that you wrote, The Lost History of Managed Retreat and Community Relocation in the United States. It's a wonderful read, but I want to quote from it. Given the inexorable pressure of climate change and sea level rise, some would argue that managed retreat may represent the next horizon in disaster management. Do you argue that?
Well, managed retreat is not easy. It should not be taken lightly. It is not the only tool in our kit. But look at the numbers. With rising sea level, there are an estimated 500 communities in the U.S. alone that are going to be heavily impacted, increasingly impacted by rising sea levels. There's also flooding along our rivers and other natural disasters. What we argue is that managed retreat, wholesale community relocation is not for everyone or every situation, but it should be part of a toolkit of addressing these, as you say, inexorable changes. Mm.
I want to cite a New Zealand example, and I have no expectation that you will even have the remotest idea what I'm talking about, except I know that you will have come across similar communities. So this is a community in Westport. It sits on the banks of a river called the Bulla River, for which the Māori name is Kawatiri, which means deep and swift, which gives you an idea of how much water flows through it. For reasons known only to themselves, in the 1800s, settlers built a community essentially in a flood area. And so they are now having a conversation. It's an existential conversation to a certain extent. There is a push for flood banks. The mayor says flood banks will buy us time, but they're not the full and final answer. So how does that community get it right?
So there's a lot baked into the question you just asked. Every community, every river, every setting is different, and those contexts are extremely important. So not knowing the context there in great detail, what I can tell you is that there is always a decision of whether to respond with an engineering solution or something else, a buyout or relocation, some cases. We have Native American communities, which are different contexts. They bring different issues to the table. So you mentioned balancing the engineering versus the relocation. So one of our classical examples was a community, Soldiers Grove, Wisconsin, and they were offered a large levee by our U.S. Army Corps of Engineers with an initial cost that was several times larger than the total assessed value of structures in the flood-prone area of downtown, and with maintenance costs that the community would have to bear that would require them to double their tax income.
Professor Pinter, can I just interrupt there? So what you're saying is the remedy cost exponentially more than the properties it was protecting, right? So that is an economic consideration. I'm looking at your brilliant work, and this is from 1978, right, Soldiers Grove. But also Soldiers Grove might have said, this is where we live. This is where our children go to school. This is where our homes are. What in New Zealand we call whakapapa, which is sense of place and history. So you can't quantify that, can you?
Kent, it's very hard to quantify, but that's pervasive. All of these communities everywhere have a sense of place. Sometimes in the U.S., 100, even 200 years of roots, and don't want to make the move. But after you've been flooded once or twice or 33 times, those pressures become overwhelming, and they overwhelm that sense of rootedness.
Can you engineer your way out of climate change?
Hard to say. again, sometimes yes. So we have what we call a sniff test, that you can look at a project that's asking for a large protection engineering investment. And what you have to look at is whether the existing infrastructure is large, whether it's dense and protectable, and whether it's already there. And in some cases, the answer is yes. Build the levee, we call it. Build the embankment. Protect the community. Sometimes that's the right solution locally. For Soldiers Grove, clearly it was not. The locals recognized that. That was federal money that they said no to because it just did not make sense.
Is it often in the long term, and we may be talking decades and even generations, cheaper to make the tough decision and relocate than it is to keep trying to keep the water out?
John, depends on the context, right? So we've worked near Bayou. I've been in Grantham, Australia, and they were hit by fatal flooding in 2011.
I remember it.
And it was clearly for a small community, it was cost effective for them to just up and move. And a wonderful story there, written up in a book, by the way, by my colleague Jamie there. And then people ask, well, how many of these lessons can be transported to sea level rise in the Gold Coast of Australia? It's hard to imagine that sort of wholesale relocation translates to the kind of infrastructure and density and cost of a densely populated coastline.
I just want to come to some of the quotes in your report. Flood damage globally may increase 160 to 240% by 2100. And there are still, boy, we're on a continuum with climate change, aren't we? Some people are hard science about it and say it's happening, we have to respond. Other people are reluctant to even acknowledge it. But by 2100, it will have imposed itself in such a profound and material fashion that actually we need to have these conversations now, don't we?
So many would say that we're seeing that in the headlines of flooding. In the US, every year brings catastrophic flooding, 2024 being no exception. And there's certainly, all scientists would agree, climate change in there. There's other factors. So humans have extensively modified our river systems, historically and prehistorically, and that's in there in our flooding as well. The result is, I would say, either way, inevitable, that some, in many cases, these are past planning errors, citing communities in flood-prone land that will have to be addressed.
I want to end on a positive note. Can you tell me, because I guess when, during the process of retreat, you're moving, and so you think, God, do I want to move somewhere else? Do I want to go to the Big Smoke? Do I want to have a whole new life? Are there communities, and you've cited a couple, that have really successfully moved en masse and reestablished themselves in a way that felt like home?
Absolutely, yes. So on the one hand, maybe a challenge is that we have this sense of rootedness, sense of place where we are. On the other hand is the opportunity to reimagine yourself, your whole community, in a new location with fresh infrastructure, a new beginning. Valmeyer, Illinois has done that very, very successfully. And they've bloomed and blossomed. And in many ways, it's more vital than it was prior to its flood in 1993.
What did they do to make that work? And because there will be people watching this in Aotearoa, New Zealand, who are hanging on every word. And I guess they're hoping that you can reassure them that it is possible to get this right in a way that resembles where their heart is, right? So what did they do there that made it work?
So every place is different, but what Valmeyer and many of the other successful relocations did is it started with a grassroots effort, that this was not our federal government coming in and say, you must move. Generally, that does not work. It has to be motivated by the community saying, never again. We do not want to endure this flood again, ever. So it has to be from the grassroots up, but it needs extensive investment. So Valmeyer was wonderful in cobbling together local sources, in fact, private sources, state sources, federal sources, and they made their relocation, their new town was beautifully designed and implemented. Others we've seen had all the right intentions and just were under-resourced. You visit those communities now, and you see that under-resourcing, under-investment today.